I suppose it was kind of the first time for a long time anyway that I heard a guitar band that really sounded exciting. Yeah, you haven't seen a band like that for some time, you know.
It's Absolute Radio. It's Danielle Perry and Paul Weller doing Through the Decades. Let's start off with your track from the 60s. You've chosen Tomorrow Never Knows from Revolver. Yeah. Tell me about your love of this record and why.
It's a big decade for me, the 60s. You know, I mean, I was only a little kid during the 60s, but I was kind of old enough still to for the music and the culture and the fashions and all of it to kind of really resound with me. And it's really stayed with me. That was the formative sort of time for me, really. The first time I saw the Beatles on TV, you know, which was November 1963. And I remember it very distinctly, you know, watching them on TV and just thinking it's just the most incredible thing. And so I suppose really from that sort of age, I kind of thought that's really what I'd like to do. So it was difficult to pick just one song from the 60s because there's so much brilliant work being made at that time. But I chose Tomorrow Never Knows by the Beatles. Because it was, and for me and still is, the most forward-looking track, not only that they've done, and it sounds like it's just beamed in from another dimension or something, you know. So I think it's a pivotal, very important track.
All right, let's hear it now. This is The Beatles with Tomorrow Never Knows. It's Absolute Radio. And now we sidestep into the 70s. When you think back to the 70s as a moment, a decade, what do you remember from that?
Well, the good bits were was the music, and I liked T-Rex and Bowie, Slade. But then I also liked a lot of soul music and a lot of reggae music I heard in the early 70s. So the song I've picked from that era, and it's Dr. Feelgood. I didn't like a lot of music that was around in the mid-70s. It was a lot of sort of stadium rock and generic American rock, and I didn't really relate to any of that stuff, you know. So Dr. Feelgood were the first band for me in the middle 70s that really kind of, they really sort of meant something to me, really. And Wilco Johnson especially, who was the guitarist, you know, he was like the first sort of 70s guitar hero for me, really. It sort of preceded punk in a lot of ways, you know. It was very short, sharp songs, spiky, and a lot of sort of aggression in it, and kind of all the things you want when you're sort of 16, 17.
Mm. Let's play Dr. Feelgood right now. This is She Does It Right. It's from 1975, written, as we were saying, by Wilco Johnson as well. She did it back. Now we go to the 80s. This was your decade of the Style Council from 83, I think, wasn't it? And you've chosen Rufus and Chaka Khan to play, which is such an anthem, isn't it? Love this record.
Yeah, I mean, again, you know, there's lots of choices I could have made. I mean, it wasn't my favourite decade, but there was still some good music nevertheless, you know. But I think this one probably means most to me. I don't know why. Probably, it was just a big tune that year, 84, I think it came out. And it was everywhere, clubs, everywhere you went. I suppose it's more for for the memories it holds for me, really, just of that time, you know. That was kind of when the Style Council were out on the road by that time, and just, again, just fun, you know, good fun. And
yeah, I can imagine. I was sort of growing up in the 80s, but everything I sort of looked back on, everything just seemed possible. It was quite big and bombastic, wasn't it? It was the decade of decadence, almost. Mm. Is that how you remember it? Yeah, big shoulders.
Yeah. Everything was bigger, wasn't it? Hair was bigger in the 80s.
Yeah, credit cards.
You know, there's lots of things I didn't like about it, you know. But everything seems possible when you're younger now. You know?
Sure.
That's probably just an age thing, you know.
Yeah, sure. All right, let's play it right now then. This is Rufus and Chaka Khan, Ain't Nobody. It's Absolute Radio. We now find ourselves in the 90s. You've chosen A Tribe Called Quest to play for your track, which I remember vividly. Why did you choose that one for us?
I thought, similar to what I was saying about the Beatles, I thought the sound on a lot of hip-hop records then, I thought it was great. I just really futuristic sounding, I thought, you know, the way they use samples and the mixture of samples and And it kind of also, a lot of hip hop tunes from that time kind of made me backtrack and find out where the samples came from. And I learned a lot of music from that, doing that, finding out who the original artists were. So that was quite a formative time for me, really. Another learning period for me.
I've had some interesting chats in here when we were working with Q Magazine, when it was going with the Q guys, who used to co-host with me, and we spoke at length with Niall Doherty, who I'm sure you've probably crossed paths with for interviews and stuff. And he was saying, you know, tribalism feels like it's gone a little bit out of music now, because it's more about the genres have all merged and it's all kind of quite song-based. How do you feel about that?
Well, it's definitely true, but I don't mind the fact it's all merged. And I notice it with my kids, some of my kids anyway, where they'll play obviously a lot of modern contemporary things, but then there'll be like an old funk track in there, or an old soul track or reggae track. And I wonder, how did you hear that? How did you get to this? You know? Which I don't know how they do that, but but I think it's interesting, and they don't really seem too bothered about the fact whether it's old or new. They just either like it, they don't like it, which ain't a bad thing.
Sweet. Let's play then A Tribe Called Quest. This is Luck of Lucene. As A Tribe Called Quest on Absolute Radio with Danielle Perry and Paul Weller, who joins us for Through the Decades. We're going to play The Strokes from the noughties. A really exciting period, I remember it. So it's almost like where rock and roll and disco balls collided, wasn't it? And
yeah.
Really exciting time. What was it about that record?
I suppose it was kind of the first time for a long time anyway that I heard a guitar band that really sounded exciting and something was familiar to you, but it was also felt really new as well, you know. And there wasn't too much else going on around that time before that, I didn't think. Then you had them, you know, and then the Libertines in England as well, and I thought they were great when they first started. So I thought it was exciting again just to hear some good guitar music again, you know.
And when you do listen back to the songs, they're so well written, aren't they? So solid, yeah. Like really brilliant.
Yeah.
And that swirl and that hype surrounding the Libertines when they were sort of in their early days was palpable. I remember sort of watching it through TV and feeling it, like with the fans. Yeah. It was exciting times, wasn't it?
It was, yeah. I remember seeing them on TV. I think it was on later. Yeah, you haven't seen a band like that for some time, you know.
For sure. I remember being very excited when this record came out as well. This is The Strokes and Last Night. We're going to talk about the 2010s now, which obviously it doesn't roll off the tongue as easy, does it? Like the naught at tens, and just feels a bit weird, doesn't it? But you chose a track from Villagers as well. He's an incredible talent, isn't he?
I think he's a genius, personally. I've loved pretty much everything he's done, and he just gets better and better for me, Connor O'Brien. And I think he's a really special artist, and hopefully he gets that recognition as well. What he's doing sonically as well, I mean, they're great songs and great lyrics, but I think sonically what he does is really different, and I think he's really pushing boundaries as well, I think, you know.
Yeah, he seems to be pushing boundaries creatively, but also bringing the masses with him, which is so reassuring sometimes, isn't it?
I hope so, yeah, because he deserves to, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Have you seen him live many times?
I saw him, I can't remember if it was recent or not. I get the years mixed up.
Me too.
They've known it to each other to me. But I did see him in recent years, yeah, and he was, yeah, amazing.
All right, let's play something now from Villagers. This is I Saw the Dead. Where I saw the dead. So Through the Decades special with Danielle Perry and Paul Weller. And now we're going to play a track from your new record,
Good.
In Better Times. We're going to play, got there eventually, didn't we? Fat Pot One is the name of it. A lot of it written, like you said, through lockdown and then finished off towards the end as well. Was it Leah from the Mysterines providing vocals on one track?
She did a song called True we wrote together, and she sings on, yeah.
Wicked, yeah. Brilliant band.
Yeah,
really like them a lot. Yeah, yeah. And what would be the overriding thing that you'd want someone to take away from this record? Is there one sort of thing lyrically or sonically?
Well, I would hope it put a smile on their faces, really. You know, I think it's got some sort of tongue-in-cheek moments, and it's got a bit of everything, really. Pathos, happiness, joy, sadness, you know. Like any good tragedy.
Exactly. Thank thank you so much for coming in.
Pleasure.
It's been an absolute joy to talk to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.